You desperate to be free. You don't care who wants you. You don't care who sitting beside you. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
Oh God.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, you know what I'm dialing, God. You know what I'm going through, Lord. Father, thank you.
Oh, how
yes, God.
I love
yes, Lord.
This place with you.
Come on, worship your God.
How I love
yes, Lord.
This place with you.
Oh, how I love this place with you.
Oh, how I love this place.
Father, we give you praise. Father, we give you the glory in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, we come at this time in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Lord. Father, we're not here for show and fashion, God. We'll come, Father, because we're desperate, Lord. Father, we're desperate, God. We're desperate for another hunger, God, for another thirst in you, God. And God, we're not perfect, God, but yet we want to be faithful. And God, we ask you to search our minds and search our heart, Lord God. And Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, you said we confess our sin. You are faithful just to forgive us and then cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Father, we hear this morning, Lord, we need help, God. Father, you know the weakness, God. You know what I'm wrestling with, God. And God, we stand before you in this place, God. Father, you know it, God. And we ask you, God. God, bring peace to our minds, God. Bring peace to the family, God. In the name of Jesus Christ, God. Father, feel like I'm about to give up, God. I feel like I'm about to lose my mind, God. But Father, I come to the church this morning, God. I come to stand in your presence, God. You said you're not a man that you should lie. I'm a son of man that you should repent, God. God, had you said it, you said you'll make it good for us, God. In the name of Jesus, Lord. Father, the marriage is in trouble, God. The finances is in trouble, God. But God, you said, God, that you are my Jehovah Jireh. That you are my provider, God. And God, I need to be free, God. I need to be free to serve you, God. I need to be free to worship you, God. I find myself, God, doing the very thing that I hate, God. But now I stand before you, God, asking for help to be free, to be free, to be free. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, come on. Come on, receive your freedom. Receive your freedom. Receive it by faith. Receive it by faith. It's your faith that will manifest in the spiritual realm. That will be manifested here in the natural realm. Yes, God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, God. Say in the name of Jesus Christ, by the Lord of God have invested in me as a son of God. I declare and I decree, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Father, you said in your word, God, in 2 Corinthians 4, 13, God, you said it is written, God, and therefore I speak, God, with the same spirit of faith, God. We believe and therefore we speak, God. I command every demonic chain, God, to be broken off you in the name of Jesus, God. I command your mind to be set free from every financial worries, from the marriage worries. I command you to be free. I command every secret sin, God, to be broken off of our lives. In the name of Jesus, God, you foul spirit, release your hope, God. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command your mind to be free. I command your soul, your will, your emotions, to be free to serve God. I break generational curse. Shut it down. Shut it down. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Father, I speak, God. And Father, in the name of Jesus, I speak your word. And Father, you know your word is alive and powerful and sharper. The enemy two double-edged sword, the person evil between the thunder of the soul and the spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, my God, as I was standing there in worship, God said, my people are being bound in this hour like never before. Can I tell you something? The hour of temptation is upon us. The Revelation 3 and 10 have said, the hour of temptation is upon us. And what that mean, preacher? That means there shall be aggression of temptation like never before. On our life, it's the hour of temptation. We're going to be always faced with temptation. But there are seasons where Satan come aggressively for temptation. And this is the hour for it. And we got to be alerted of sober mind like never before. If I can get somebody to turn the lights on, I appreciate it. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for your word. Father, I've already written in the spirit realm that should be manifest in this hour, God. And Father, I pray that you anoint our hearing, God. Not only to hear, but to receive, Lord. That the word bring change, God. Father, we thank you for the Logos word that is written, my God. We also thank you for the Rhema word, the spoken word that you have spoken, Lord. And Father, I thank you, Lord. For another opportunity, and Father, it is just that, another opportunity. And Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you forgive me, Lord, that there be no hindrance, God, for you allow me to speak thy word in the name of Jesus Christ. And forgive us corporately, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And Father, I bless your people today. I call them blessed. Father, I call them highly favored in the name of Jesus Christ, God. And Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus Christ that their present time suffering cannot be compared to the glory of the Lord that should be upon them in the name of Jesus Christ. And Lord, forgive us as a corporate body for worrying, God, of the things of this world, God. Forgive us, God, for shifting our focus from you, our Jehovah Jireh, that God, that say, may get us to look at other sources to meet our need. Father, we are sorry, God, for allowing Satan to shift our focus, God. For you are our provider, God. And we look to you, God, the author and finisher of our faith in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And Father, we give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, before you sit down, come on and clap your hands for the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Can I tell you I love you this morning? I love you with the love of God. Praise God. Kentrell Smith, the young man I just met at the altar. Praise God. Hallelujah. Bless you, my brother. Bless you. Bless you. And give an honor to Pastor Miller and Sister Miller. Praise God. And everyone that are absent, we do thank God for what God is doing here in this ministry. Praise God. Thank God for my family that is here. My wife, my daughter, praise. My goddaughters, my brother, hallelujah. And bless you, New Life, in the name of Jesus Christ. Again, there's a word from the Lord, hallelujah. Praise God. We thank him. We thank him, hallelujah. We thank him. Another opportunity to worship him. Another opportunity that we can stand before God. And I say to you, church, don't worry about a thing that's not going right in your life. If we would just get in that place and worship God, I promise you, we would see the end. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. We do thank God for the Vacation Bible School. That vision was birthed in Sister Tim. We thank God for it. And when God gives us a vision, it's not easy. It is not easy. But God said if we be faithful, if we don't get tired or don't become weary in well-doing, we will reap in his due time. Amen. So we can't get tired of living for God. God, I tell you, when you make up your mind to live for God and take care of God's business, God gonna take care of your business. I promise you that. Hallelujah. You're looking at a man that was bound by crack cocaine for 3 years. You're looking at a man that thought suicide was the only way out from crack cocaine. But God and the power of God came in my daddy bathroom and delivered me some 20 years ago. I never been to a rehab. I never had a withdrawals. I'm talking about the power of God came and broke demonic shackles off my life, because if Satan would have had his way, I would be dead in my grave. But God is real. He ain't no church God. He is the living God. All we got to do is make up our mind and worship him for real. Hallelujah. I'm not going to lie on God. I'm talking about the anointing power of God to break yokes off our life. I don't care if it's alcohol. I don't care what kind of secret sin that you're dealing with. I don't care where you find yourself doing the very thing you hate. If you just go ahead and be consistent and persistent in the secret place of God, he will show out for you. My God. Go into your own room. Close your door and pray to me in secret, God said, and watch me reward you openly. He ain't lying. Hallelujah. Many trials I have been in. Many yokes of bondage I have been in. Computer pornography, it was me. Fornication, it was me. Alcohol, it was me. I said crack, it with me. Powder cocaine, it with me. And a free man stand before you, I am. Hallelujah. And by all means, I don't stand before you as being perfect. I stand before you as being faithful to God. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. I thought I was going to lose my mind when my mama died and I was a junior in high school. I thought I was going to lose my mind when grandma died and my granddaddy died. But God said, I am your mother. I am your father. Hallelujah. He ain't no church God to me. He is my living God. Hallelujah. And we will see the difference between church people and kingdom-minded people. Yes, God. We break religious bondage off our minds. Yes, God. Yes, God. He's more real than I'm looking at you and you looking at me. He's more real. Hallelujah. He ain't no God that we experience on a Sunday morning. He's an everyday Jehovah Jireh, our provider in our life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. When I didn't know no way, he made a way. When I got fired from a job, I didn't know how I was going to make it. I had a house note. I had bills. And I knew I was the head of the household. And I was fear had gripped my mind. But God met my need. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He ain't no church God to me. Hallelujah. He's Abba. He's my daddy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I thank God for my natural dad and my natural mama. But I ain't crazy. He's my real daddy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He's keeping me. If I sit up and tell you it is easy preaching this gospel and going out into this world to live a civilian life, I would be lying. Devil come all kind of ways. But God is keeping me faithful in my marriage. I ain't going to sit up and lie and tell you it's easy. I ain't going to sit up and lie and tell you they ain't trying to holler at me. But God is keeping me faithful. Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I don't want to be a castaway after I preach to you and find myself a castaway. That devil's a lie. Continue to keep me, God. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Thank you for keeping me. That my baby, when she grow up, she can say when she's grown, my daddy was faithful to God. We living in an hour. Great preachers are falling. They're falling, I tell you. They're falling. Satan is trying to make trophies of hell. Hallelujah. But we got to learn to be kingdom-minded men and women of God. And that's what we're going to teach today. The difference between church people and kingdom-minded people. And let me tell you something. New life in this great last days, the fourth quarter of these days, God is seeking out kingdom-minded sons and daughters of God. You can always tell what's going on in the spirit realm by looking at the measurement in the natural realm. And we see in the natural realm, Satan have lost his mind. Everywhere we go, shooting and killing. But let me tell you something. God is right there. He's desperately looking for a people of kingdom mind and mentality that can break this thing. Let me go on with the word. I was at work and I was reading last Friday's newspaper, the July the 12th newspaper. And I picked it up. And I was reading about where Commercial News was interviewing our pastor, Pastor Miller, and relating to the gun violence that's in our city. And as I was reading this, I was smiling. I was just thanking God for raising up our pastor to not only to be the pastor of one church in two locations here in the Champaign-Urbana area. But also with thanking God for raising up our pastor to be a leader in this community. Listen to this, a leader where the city mayor and city officials and school board members who he's meeting with and where they have called him to help find a solution to the gun violence that's here in our city. Already this year alone, we are in the seventh month of the year, of the calendar year. Five more months we still have to go. There have been 18 shootings in Danville. Five have related in death. We are ranked number 86 on the 100 most dangerous city in America to live in. How did they get this number? This number is calculated on one crime per 1,000 resident based on a 25,000 plus populated city. This is how they came to that calculation. And the city officials and the city mayor, the school board members have called upon Pastor Miller. But let me tell you something, don't downplay this, because see, the head can't do nothing without the body. The city leaders have called upon New Life Church of Faith. And as I was thinking about this, God began to say to me, he said, son, don't you see that the natural city leaders have called upon my spiritual leaders and my spiritual people to conquer a spiritual demon in the spiritual realm that will manifest peace in the natural realm in the city of Danville that will bring me glory. Jesus, what you say, God? He said, the city natural leaders have called upon my spiritual leaders and my spiritual people to conquer a spiritual demon in the spiritual realm that will manifest in the natural realm, that will manifest peace in this city, that will bring me glory. And New Life, we got to get results for God. Let me show you what God showed me. God has placed New Life Church of Faith on the front line of spiritual warfare to come against this giant this uncircumcised spirit of murder who Satan have assigned to our city to steal, kill, and to demolish the unsaved. Now, we can be church people, come to church on Sunday, and never come against the spirit of murder. But let me tell you something. In the spirit realm, God has placed us on the front line of spiritual warfare. Now, I did not say the natural leaders have called upon church leaders and church people. I said, God said he have called upon spiritual leaders and spiritual people. In other words, God said they have called upon my sons and daughters of kingdom-minded mentality. You may ask, well, Olin, what's the difference between church people and kingdom-minded people? Well, let me finish reading my article. And I tell you. So as I'm finished reading this article, I was reading what Pastor Miller was telling Commercial News that we're going to start off this prayer walk, which should have taken place last Saturday. He said, we're going to start off with a peaceful prayer walk. In our own neighborhood, unified, everybody wearing white. And you may ask, well, why come we're not just walking where Satan have claimed domain in the Fair Oaks area? Well, simple. We're not ready. And I'll get to it in a little bit. But he's told Commercial News, Pastor Miller did, that we're going to start off with a peaceful prayer walk. We're not going to solicit neighbors. We're not going with bullhorns. In other words, he said we're going to walk a peaceful prayer walk manifesting Galatians 5 and 22. We're going to walk in peace while we're praying, and at the same time showing the people that are not saved, we're going to show them love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control, and faith while we are walking. We're going to show them peace. But can I tell you something, New Life? While we're walking and praying, there is no peace in praying. There is no peace in spiritual warfare. God said in 2 Corinthians 10 and 3, he said, as you walk, he said, understand, as we walk, there's war. The weapon of warfare is not carnal, but mighty through God and pulling down and conquering the strongholds. And as we walk in the flesh, listen to this, we do not war after the flesh. So ain't no peace in warfare. Jesus said it in Matthew 10 and 34. He said, now listen to me. He said, now I didn't come to this earth to bring peace. No. I didn't come to bring peace, but I came to bring a sword. What are you saying, Jesus? He said, I came to bring my word that's alive and powerful and sharper. The end of two double-edged swords that person even between the thunder of the soul and the spirit and the joint and the marrow. Jesus said, I didn't come to bring peace in the spirit realm. He said, I come with my sword to divide. To divide what, God? To divide the kingdom of darkness from the kingdom of light. I come to divide, listen to this, my sons and daughters of God from the sons and daughters of the devil. Where this old devil, according to 2 Corinthians 4 and 4, where he has blinded the minds of those that can't believe this gospel. And where, according to 1 Corinthians 1 and 18, where the devil have made this word foolish to the unsaved. He said, I come to separate church people from my kingdom-minded people. Elder Odoms, tell me the difference between church people and kingdom-minded people. And I will understand, first of all, church people have both groups have confessed Jesus Christ as their Savior, according to Romans 10, verse 9 and 10. that you confess with your mouth, Lord Jesus Christ, believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the grave, you shall be saved. With the heart of man believing to righteousness, with the mouth confession made unto salvation. Yes, church people as well as kingdom-minded people have confessed and believed in faith that Jesus Christ died for them. Yes, but the difference between church people and kingdom-minded people, both have confessed Jesus Christ as Savior, but it's the kingdom people who have Jesus Christ as Lord over their life. What church people that's made the confession, but he's not Lord yet over their life. Church people, listen to this, have a kingdom later mentality that said, well, I know that if I die, I know I'm going to heaven, and that is so. But kingdom-minded people say, yes, when I die, I'm also going to heaven. But kingdom-minded people got revelation knowledge of Luke 17 and 21 that tell us, and this is Jesus talking to the church people. He said, you looking for the kingdom. He said, understand, the kingdom won't come with you carefully looking for it. Neither will you say, there it is, or here it is. He said, the kingdom of heaven is within you. So the kingdom-minded people know, yes, one day I'm going to heaven, but I got revelation knowledge of Luke 17 and 21 that tell me the kingdom of heaven is within me. And because I got revelation knowledge of Luke 17 and 21, that a kingdom now mentality, that the kingdom of heaven was within me, then I know Matthew 10 and 7 that tells, well, the kingdom of heaven is right here, right now. Not only is the kingdom of heaven within me, but the kingdom of heaven is here. Every time I wake up, I'm waking up with the kingdom of heaven. Every time I pray, I'm praying with the kingdom of heaven. Jesus, 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 are you receiving this? Jesus, let's begin to extend your right hand from me. We all of a sudden got interruption in the spirit realm. Because see, the spirit of heaviness, the spirit of tiredness have came upon some of the body to keep them from receiving the word. And I ain't gonna play with no devil. I ain't got time for that. You spirit of heaviness, point to the atmosphere. You spirit of heaviness, you spirit of tiredness, that's trying to rain down heavy on God's people of tiredness and sleepiness, loose your hope and go in the name of Jesus. Now come on, stand and clap your hands for what God just lifted off us. If I study this word all night, my God, you gonna listen. And ain't no spirit gonna keep you from it. I lost sleep, so you gonna lose sleep. That devil's a lie. My wife said, babe, you really ain't been spending time with me. I said, well, babe, I'm studying. I lost time with my wife. I lost time with sleep. Ain't no sleeping in here today. I lost sleep. You gonna lose sleep. Saying you a lie. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Yes, God. You can be seated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We got to train our soul. Either you gonna follow the spirit or you gonna follow the flesh. Tell your soul you gonna follow the spirit. See, you got to talk to your soul like David did. He said, my soul, why are you so downcast? And why are you so sad? He was talking to his soul. Because your soul going to follow the spirit or you going to follow the flesh. And we got to be a kingdom-minded person to talk to the soul. Soul, ain't going to be no lusty looking today. Soul, you going to study the word today. Soul, you going to fast today, so you not going to eat another piece of that cake. I'm talking to myself now, so no gluttony today. Speak to the soul. Train that soul, or it going to train us. Hallelujah. We're living in the last days, people. And God said, no more can I wink at the ignorance. We're living in a very serious time. our babies, young men, young ladies in our city are dying way before their time. Don't let nobody tell you, well, they died, it was just their time. That devil is a lie. They die way before their time. And we are the church of the Lord Jesus Christ that God have put on the front line to come against this spirit of murder. Let them do what they're going to do in the natural realm. But we know where the source, where the root is. It's in the spirit. Hallelujah. Kingdom-minded men and women of God know that the kingdom of heaven is within us. And they also know, since it's in us, according to Matthew 10 and 7, it is right here, right now. Now, let me bring a reminder of the last time I mounted this platform. Kingdom-minded women of God, you know that you have to spend time in the secret place of the Most High. The secret place, according to Matthew 6 and 6, and I just quoted that scripture, go into your own room, close the door, pray to your Father in secret, He will reward you openly. Every time you get in a secret place, can I tell you something? That is the spiritual womb of God. In the natural realm, Satan would get you to downplay that, to say, well, I'm just in my room praying. No, no, no. When you have found a place in your home where you meet God and you have sanctified that place for God, just you and God, and you pray that in that place, that's in the spiritual realm, God's spiritual womb. This is where we hear and see the face of God. This is where we grow. You don't grow in church. You grow in the secret place. This is where we receive revelation knowledge. This is where chains are broken from secret sin, from any form of addiction. It is broken in the secret place. Crack cocaine was broken off my life in the secret place when I sat aside in my daddy house in the bathroom. That was my place of prayer where I met God, and He broke that thing. So ladies, remember the last time I mounted this platform, God said that you in the secret place, as a kingdom-minded woman of God, you got to spend time in the secret place and allow God to get you to do the office of the spiritual midwife, that you can birth out this city, that you can birth out your family, that you can birth out your sons and your daughters and even your husband. When things ain't acting right in the family, let me tell you something. You can fight a spiritual situation through the natural means of head knowledge. Do what you got to do in the natural, but the root of the thing come from being broken in the secret place. And every chance I get, I'm going to remind every woman of God to be that of Shaphar and Puya, the first two midwives that Exodus chapter 1, 15 through the 22nd verse talked about when they did the office of the midwife. And every chance I get, kingdom-minded mentality woman of God, I'm going to remind you that God said, do the office of the midwife. Be a birthing mother. Cast the stools of the altar and birth this thing out that you're going through in your family. Every chance I get, like a screwdriver, I want to screw it in your spirit until you get a revelation knowledge that God is trying to raise up here in New Life Church of Faith for the woman of God to do the office of the midwife. And you heard me before the last time I mounted this platform. The office of the midwife is just as important as the office of the pastor, teacher, prophet, evangelist, and an apostle. For that man of God, the man of God, the kingdom-minded mentality man of God, understand, it was Joab in 1 Kings 2 and 28 who was the commander-in-chief of David's army. Joab, no, he was not perfect again, but he was faithful. He knew he had messed up. And what did Joab do? He didn't allow pride and condemnation keep him from coming to the altar. That's what Satan do. It's one thing, man of God, listen to me. It's one thing to get in sin. But it's a whole nother thing altogether to allow Satan to keep us down. God mean a just man falling down seven times. That name seven means many times. A just man falling down seven times. But what make him just? He get back up. But it then goes on to say, but the prudent man continue in his evil ways. But the kingdom-minded man, with that kingdom-minded mentality, know that when I do fall, you got to be like Joab. We got to catch the horns of the altar and say, God, forgive me, Lord, and help me, God. Forgive me. And whatever that sin you did, God know what you did. But to free yourself, you got to say, God, forgive me for that adultery. Forgive me for that fornication. Why? Because when you speak it, it's a releasing in your soul. We getting ready for warfare to face the spirit of murder today. I'm not preaching to your soul. I'm preaching to your spirit to awaken the spirit man to consistency and persistency in prayer. For too long, we have been New Life Church people. And at the end of the service, we're going to have a test. It's a self-test to see whether or not we are still bathed in Christ or have we been birthed to maturity. It's a test where God said we're going to judge ourselves. Let me tell you, and I said the last time I mounted this platform, and I keep bringing, I don't care if it's Bible study, I don't care if I mount this platform, God going to always bring me back to that secret place. Every time we make up our mind, and I did say we, God ain't going to pick us up and carry us to that secret place. And this hour of temptation, God allows, well, let me start from the beginning. In this hour of temptation, I was talking to Pastor Miller. He the one first mentioned this hour of temptation. But after I got off the phone, God said, study that. And I started studying the hour of temptation. Turn with me to Revelation 3 and 10. Revelation 3 and 10. Yes, God. Revelation 3 and 10. Revelation 3 and 10. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from what? The hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon this earth. Now, theologians and scholars believe that the hour of temptation is the tribulation period that's going to come after Jesus Christ coming, rapture us up to heaven, and then come the 7-year tribulation. That is true. But I also believe Revelation 3 and 10, is what I said earlier, is a season where Satan come aggressively to tempt us. And God allows this to happen because God see it as the hour of testing. Satan come looking at it as the hour of temptation to take us out from God. God see it as the hour of testing to see what's really in our hearts. That's so very important. And we are in this hour. You have permit in your life right now, temptation is at every hand. Wives, he won't tell you, but let me tell you, he's tempted on every hand in this hour. Wives, husbands, she ain't gonna say, but she's tempted on every hand like never before in this hour. And it's a progression. It is a flood of temptation this hour. And Isaiah 59 and 19 tells us, when the enemy comes in like a flood, our temptation, aggressive temptation, God said, I will lift up a standard. But let me tell you something. Let's not be church people. Because in order for God to lift up a standard, when the enemy come in like a flood, God got to have a standard of living from his people to be pulled up from that he may live. So in order to have a standard, when the hour of temptation come upon us and our families, God said, I must see. In order for me to be Jehovah Nisi, your victor, your banner, your life, I must have from you, son and daughter, a standard of holiness. Can I tell you something else? Coming with this hour of temptation. Job chapter 2. The angels came to present themselves before God, and it said that the devil came with him. And God said, Satan, where you been? Where you come from? And he said, walking to and fro on this earth, back and forth. And when I read that, I thought about God when he said, Satan is like a roaring lion seeking the one he made the vow. If you think of a lion, when the lion find their prey, he eat up greedily. And of course, you know the word seeking means he's looking. In this hour of temptation, if we any inkling is not putting that thought down, that hour will come upon us where you find yourself leaving the church and cussing somebody out in traffic. This is the hour of temptation like never before. Let me show you this. You may ask, well, Pastor Miller, we did this prayer walk in our own neighborhood, and I told you I'd get back with you. Why didn't we didn't go in Fair Oaks where Satan have claimed domain? He have claimed that area as a fortified place to himself, this Fair Oaks area. Well, I thank God that he told Pastor Miller, start in your own neighborhood first. Because in the natural realm, when I joined the Army Reserve, I understand that I didn't just join and they say, okay, go and fight in war. No, there's basic training. There's AIT. They had to get you prepared. And there's no way we could have went to Satan's fortified place and faced this uncircumcised giant, this spirit of murder, without us being consecrated, fasted up, and prayed up. That would have been casualties in the spirit realm. That would have been counterattacks in the spirit realm. Can I tell you something? This is what we call presumptuous sin. David said in Psalms 19 and 13, he said, Lord, keep me from presumptuous sin that my enemy won't have dominion over me. New Life, we've been dealing with presumptuous sin, deceived by it too long. What's presumptuous sin, Elder Odom? Presumptuous sin is this, and God gave me this. I didn't look up no dictionary. I'm writing to hear. He said presumptuous sin is failing to discern or failing to spiritually see, listen to this, the limits of what been set to conquer a spiritual demon. It is not meeting the requirements where Luke 12 and 48 said, who much is given, much is required. Presumptuous sin said, going or not meeting the limits of requirement to pursue a thing. Meaning we're not meeting the requirements to do what it takes to get the spirit of murder out of our community. Presumptuous sin says this. Well, Pastor Miller say, walk in our neighborhood. Well, I'm going to go ahead and just walk and find walks and come against this spirit of murder. We have not fasted. We have not prayed. And then Acts 19 tells us the demon said, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? Presumptuous sin said, I'm saved. I can do it. And by all means, I'm not glorifying the enemy. But let me tell you something. The Bible says he's cunning. And Satan strategically set up the kingdom of darkness. But we in this hour cannot be no more church people. Because we are on the front line of spiritual warfare in the spirit realm. And New Life, there is no room for mistakes. And can I tell you something, New Life? I said in the spiritual realm that calling Pastor Miller, city officials, city mayor, school board members, a head can't go without the body. And God showed me, just as sure as you hear me yelling through this microphone, he showed me a little building on the hill. And that was symbolic of us being on the front line of warfare. And because we are planted like that tree by the rivers of water, let me tell you something. This is not the season to get in willful sin. Because whether you want to or not, you have been drafted on this front line. And Satan is angry because this has been exposed. Angry. Angry. He showed me this with my mother-in-law. Because God have raised her up to be a midwife. And Brother Dirk opened that door of the season of early morning prayer. And my mother came and just took the altar by the horn and would be here every morning. And now she have gotten this sickness, and thank God she's well. But and I'm not going to tell her testimony, because it's a mighty testimony. Satan knew, if I can get the midwife out of the way, I'm coming from the church. Because she would meet God every morning at 6 o'clock praying for the church. And I know there's others. But in the spirit realm, it was an attack upon her to get to this front line of New Life Church of Faith. New Life, I wish you can hear my heart as I'm trying to preach. We cannot get into presumptuous sin and look at it as, okay, church this, church that, I can't stand him, I can't stand her. Because we are on the front line. And if you have never prayed before, I break the spirit of laziness, complacency, procrastination off your life. That the women can be the spiritual midwife and the men can be the prayer generous for their family and for this church. We're almost coming to a close, and I want to show you this. Turn with me to Luke 11. We're having Bible study right now. We are in training for this war. You have been drafted. Luke 11, 24. We're going to read 24 and 25. And I'm reading from the King James Version, Luke 11, 24, 25. When an unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest. And finding none, he said, I will return unto the house from which I came. Now, this is the demon. This is Jesus relaying to us what the demon thinking, that the mindset of Satan, who have assigned this demon. 25. And when he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished. Then goeth he and take to him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there, and the least state of that man is worse than the first. Now this scripture applies to the unsaved as well as the saved, and referring to demons. Now it do us no good to go to Fair Oaks and tell my praying of the unsaved, casting out a devil, if they're not saved, because they would be worse off. Seven other spirits, you ready for yourself, would come. Well, what about us, preacher? We are saved. We got the Holy Ghost dwelling us, possessing us. So can no demon possess us spiritually? However, according to this scripture, we can't be possessed. But we, as the sons and daughters of God, we can be oppressed in our soulish realm, which is our mind, our will, and our emotion. Why he got that towel on his head? I heard you. Because I want to show you how the demons oppress our mind. Demons cannot read our minds. But I've said always, they interject thoughts in our minds. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. Weapon our warfare is not carnal, but it's mighty through God, pulling down demonic stronghold, cast down every imagination, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. When that thought come in your mind, you depressed, you oppressed, your marriage not going to make it. You might as well forget it. You might as well kill yourself. You might as well smoke this. You might as well do this. Whenever a condemning thought come in your mind, we have to do, as kingdom-minded men and women of God, we got to do what the Bible taught us to do. We got to bring that thought down. How, preacher? Your mouth is the focal point of spiritual warfare. Satan, that is not my thought. In the name of Jesus Christ, I bring that thought down. Well, you ugly, you this, you that. I bind that thought in the name of Jesus. Well, look at your wife. You really don't want her. You want this other woman. I bind this thought in the name of Jesus. Well, you know your husband really can't please you. You want this man, you want that man. I bind that thought in the name of Jesus. And if we don't, though the money condemning thoughts take roots like a tree growing in a field. And as you see this towel on my head, it is called a demonic stronghold. Satan have found a fortified place in your soul, a working center, a nucleus, a driving force to drive you. You can't tell me that a prostitute was born a prostitute. You can't tell me a homosexual was born a homosexual. You can't tell me a man of God preaching the word and all of a sudden fall into adultery and lose his life prematurely. That's a demonic stronghold on the mind. Wearing it just like I'm wearing this towel. And the demon said, well, we can't possess their spirit, but we can possess their mind. And then we find ourselves continuing doing the very thing we hate. We do it, and we feel bad at God. Wake up! We feel bad about it. We feel bad about it. Now you hear me. We feel bad about it. We repent, and we go back and do it again. What I'm saying, you are now being influenced by a demon just as real as you hear me. You hear what I just said? A demon. They have found a place in this mind. We got to get prepared before we start walking in fair oaks. Let me show you some mess. Look with me to Matthew chapter 12. He is still wearing a towel on his head. This is how these things are broken. Matthew 12. And while you're turning there, let me say this. You might say, well, preacher, I'm dealing with a secret sin. My wife don't know. My husband don't know. And preacher, I really want to be free. Sometimes I don't even like coming to church because I feel like everybody's looking at me. That's another tool of the enemy. It's called condemnation. God will never condemn you, but he will always convict you to come to true repentance. And when God forgives you, he remembers that sin no more. As far as the east is from the west. Now, preacher, I'm really dealing with this sin. I really hate it. I do it, and I find myself coming to repentance, and then I find myself doing it again. Because of this demonic hole on our mind. Well, let me show you, if you're serious about being free, if you're serious about breaking generational curse off your family, where daddy was an alcohol, son is alcohol, granddaddy was an alcoholic, and can I tell you something else? Sister got cancer, auntie got cancer, grandmama had cancer. Whenever you find it like that, it is called generational curse. It ain't by happenstance. Understand that. God said, my people, Hosea 4 and 6, my people are dying because of the lack of knowledge, because we're not studying and meditating on the word of God. And you heard me on last time where God gave me that prophetic vision, how the demon of error is lurking deep within the word of God to bring error. And what I can see, the greatest error upon us as the church is presumptuous sin to say, well, everything's going to be all right. No, everything's not going to be all right if we are not meeting the requirements of God. God cannot override his spiritual laws. It is already set. And God said, I can't move in your life until I have a consecrated vessel to move through. Kids' rebellion, and the whole household in the wreck, somewhere a demon have been planted. Now, we serious about getting that demon out of our marriage, out of our finance, off our children, off our own mindset. The Bible says something comes out nothing but prayer and fasting. You may say, well, preacher, I'm not really familiar on fasting. Well, start light and do it right. Start with 4 hours. And you petition God, God, I really never fast, but my kids is acting up, my marriage is in trouble, me and my hubby are living in the same household, and God, we're really not speaking. I wake up in the morning, I'm just as mean, and ain't nobody did nothing to me. I look at him, and I'm just mean, God. Is that in here? I know they ain't in here. I felt it when I said it. But if we serious about breaking that thing, for those who really know nothing about fasting, it is consecrating yourself, abstaining from food, that the spirit in you, the spirit can be sensitive to hear from God. And what you do, you say, God, if you never fast before, start with 2 hours or 4 hours. And for that 2 and 4 hours, you shut down Facebook, you shut down the TV, you shut down the phone. And for 2 hours, you praying and you meditate on God. And you say, God, I'm fasting that this spirit can be broken out from my family, whatever that spirit is, be it sickness or be some kind of fleshly sin. Because we have lost, let me tell you something, we have lost too much in the spirit realm, New Life. We're going to be shocked when we go to heaven and see what we could have had on this earth. Let me finish telling you. How to break it? You fast and you speak to that thing. And it will break. But our problem is once it break, we got to be disciplined. If it's computer pornography and you serious about it and you in fast and it broke, get that thing out the house. Whatever it is, after fasting and praying and consecrating in the natural realm, you have to be disciplined. We have to set up boundaries. That's if you're serious. Look at Matthew 12. We're almost close for the test. Matthew 12 and 25. We're free, so I can take the towel off. Matthew 12 and 25. Matthew 12 and 25. We're going to read the 25th verse down through the 29th verse. Matthew 25. Now, I'm reading this to show you why it's so imperative, why it's so important, why right now we can't be in presumptuous sin and just walk out in Fair Oaks and come against this spirit a murder. Okay? I'm going to show you. Matthew 12, 25 to 29. And Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself should not stand. 26. And if Satan is cast out, Satan, he is divided against himself and shall then his kingdom stand? How should his kingdom stand? And if I, by Beelzebul, cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges. 28. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is coming to you. And this is what I want to emphasize. 29, look at this. Or else, how can one enter a demonic strong man's house and spoil his good unless he first what? And then he will spoil his house. Let me show you or dissect Satan's strategic, diabolical plan he has set up in Fair Oaks and the other areas of this city where there's aggressively of crime. We have Satan. You have his hierarchy, principality, power, rulers of darkness, spirit, wickedness. You have Satan, his hierarchy. Then you have his demonic strongman spirits. And then you have his subordinate demons. And they all take orders from that order. The demon that we're faced with in Fair Oaks is a demonic strongman of jealousy. The spirit of murder is not the strongman. He's a subordinate that get the orders from the demon or the demonic strongman of jealousy. What's your source, preacher? The first murder in the Bible was Cain killing his twin brother Abel. They both gave sacrifice unto the Lord. But Cain did not give it with a heart of faith like Abel did. And he became jealous because God accepted Abel's sacrifice and not Cain. And because of the demonic strongman of jealousy was upon his soul, his mind and wills, his emotion, that opened the door up to anger and rage. And God said to Cain, he asked Cain, why are you so angry? Why are you so downcast? He said, if you do good, will I not accept your offering? He said, but if not, understand that demon is at the door of your soul. He didn't heed the voice. He didn't heed the warning. Yes, Lord. And God just said to me, and I'm going to say it to you, some of you here today is not heeding the warning right now. Some of us in here are in willful sin. Willful sin. And you will not heed this warning. I would hate to say, listen to me closely. Listen to me closely. I would hate to be preaching to someone in here and you end up in hell. Hear what I just said? Because that demonic stronghold got such a grip on your mind, you hear this warning from me of God and walk through them doors going right back to the playground of Satan. And Lord forbid, and I'm looking at you and you hear my voice, and when you die, your spirit and soul leave your body and you end up in hell. Please hear the warning, the same warning God gave Cain. And as a result, Cain killed his brother because the spirit of jealousy was upon him, which opened the door up to anger and rage and opened the door up to murder. So as we go to Fair Oaks, we first got to bind the demon of jealousy, the demon of anger and rage, and then deal with that murdering spirit. Amen? Now I want to give you this test before we pray. It's a test. Now understand, according to 1 Corinthians 11 and 31, I can't judge you. You can't judge me. But God did say in Matthew 7 and 16 that you would know them by their fruits. But 1 Corinthians 11 and 31, God said, judge yourself that I may not judge you. And now nobody in here wants God to judge them. I'm going to give you a test. And the title of the test is this. You might be a babe in Christ, or you might be a church people if. I'm going to read out 7 statements. And if you find yourself in one of these statements, judge yourself that God may not judge you. Because see, why God got us on the front line, he can't use church people. He can only use kingdom-minded people. And God just spoke to me. He said, tell them that your life, the way we're living, our life the fountain of our living can only go as high as your river of praying. Hear what I just said? Your fountain of how you live in your life can only go as high as you praying and God hearing us. God hearkened to our prayer first based on how we live in our life. But presumptuous sin said, well, I'm saved. I go to church. God, give me this. God, give me that. Blah, blah. But we ain't meeting the requirements of holy living. Let's do this test. And I first want to tell you this. I don't know if you heard of Jack Cole before we read the test. Jack Cole was a mighty man of God, a great healing evangelist in the 60s and 70s, Jack Cole. And Oral Roberts said of Jack Cole, he have never seen nobody on this earth had of great faith as Jack Cole. Eyes, blind eyes open, cripple, you name it. God used him, Jack Cole. But Jack Cole had a spirit of jealousy. Jack Cole, it was a tent ministry he had. Jack Cole would go out and measure Oral Roberts' tent and go buy another tent bigger than Oral Roberts and say, I got the biggest tent. But see how he was missing God? And God was still using him. But God told Kenneth Hagin, he said, go and tell my servant to judge himself in three areas. Judge himself on how he treat people, especially fellow ministers. He said, tell him to deal with that spirit of jealousy. That was the first one. He said, also tell him to judge himself in the area of the love of money. Thirdly, he said, tell my servant to judge himself in the area of his diet. And Kenneth Hagin did it. And in the midst of God using Jack Cole and miracles, signs, and wonders, Jack Cole died at the age of 38. God had to bring him home. Because God was using him in miracles, but at the same time, he was bringing shame on God. He's in heaven, yes, but it went way before his time. Let me tell you something, New Life. We can dare the devil, but once you start daring God, that's when you find yourself in a whole lot of trouble. Since it's powerful, babe, let me say it again. You can dare the devil, but when you find yourself daring God, that's when you find yourself in trouble. And God will have no choice but to bring you home before he allows to continue bringing shame on his name. Especially the ministers. Now I want you to judge yourself according to 1 Corinthians 11 and 31. Judge yourself that you be not judged. And I already took the test. The word had to come through me before it had to come to me before it come through me. You might be a babe in Christ or you might be a church people if you find yourself, number one, if you find yourself fighting with other Christians. Judge yourself. And God is using me right now as he used Kenneth Hagin to tell Jack Cole. He's using me now to tell you as he have told me, judge yourself. This is my warning. Number two, you might be a babe in Christ or a church person if you enjoy being the center of attention. Number three. You might be a church person or a babe in Christ if you come to church when you feel like it. That means a church person that is birthed out of their soulish realm and not out of the spirit of God. The soul, my mind, my will, my emotions. So I'm birthed from my soul rather than being birthed from the spirit of God. Where he said, forsake not the assembly of joining yourself before other believers. The next You might be a babe in Christ or a church person when you have very little knowledge of the Word of God. Where did that come from? When we don't study and meditate on this Word, when you don't pick up your Bible until you come to church from the next Sunday to the next Sunday, when you say, I have forgotten about Bible study, and saying, love it when you don't know the Word. Hosea 4:10 describes it all. My people die from the lack of knowledge, revelation knowledge. Next one. You might be a babe in Christ. Listen to this. If you are easily offended when you wear your feelings on your shirt sleeve. This is where God said we got to learn to be unoffendable. He said in 2 Timothy, endure hardship like a good soldier. What's the next one? You might be a babe in Christ if you find yourself never satisfied in church. And when you find yourself like that, you're being used by the enemy to bring hindrance to the growth of the ministry. And God don't take that lightly. What's the next one, preacher? You might find yourself a babe in Christ or a church person when you always have trouble staying clean. Meaning, when Satan got kicked out of heaven, he got kicked out into the realm of darkness. And when we open that door to darkness, that is Satan's area of operation. What's the next one? You might find yourself a babe in Christ where you become jealous over the success of others. That meaning Satan have shifted our focus. And if we, you, it's me, if you found yourself in any one of these statements, it's time to take out the most spiritual diapers and put on the whole armor of God. New Life, God is raising up our pastor in this community to lead the war against the spirit of murder. And we have been drafted. We can leave this today and continue in presumptuous sin, meaning every day I'm doing the same old thing, but nothing changing in my life or in my family life. That's called complacency. But God has petitioned us to come against this uncircumcised giant, this demon of murder. And we got to be ready. Lane, give me some music. I will ask the ministers, could you please come? And we're going to pray. And we're going to pray that yokes, keep it down low for me, that yokes be broken. Whatever you petition the man of God for, this ain't the time to allow pride or shame to come. Because we're in the midst of warfare, folks. And not only have Satan petitioned the Fair Oaks area, he have petitioned our families. But this is truly, let us all stand, please. This is truly the hour of temptation. There's no red carpet. I don't know where it is. But you find yourself needing to be birthed out. And all of what you just said, touch my heart. There's demonic holes upon my mind. Turn up a little bit, man. And this is the hour where Satan have aggressively target us as sons and daughters of God. Please, if you can stand, everybody stand. If you can please stand, everybody stand.
What I decree.
Yes, God.
Yes, I
yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
It belongs
the hour where we have to be free.
Speak with him,
this is the hour.